We used to be the lost people, deserving no grace. But because of His love, God's love, we are here to proclaim that we are the true followers of Jesus. Amen. With all our heart, let's stand up, church, and sing the conference theme song. Come, follow me. And no turning back,
no turning back.
Come on, everyone.
The one behind me, the cross before me. No turning, no turning back.
I have
decided to follow me.
To follow
me.
Come on,
follow me.
Come on, follow me.
It's easy, my brother.
Selamat datang sama-sama. It's an honor for us to be able to host everyone here from 27 countries all over Asia and other parts of the world. So on behalf of Southeast Asia region and the whole Asia region here as well, we'd like to welcome everyone again. Can you believe 60% of the whole world population are in Asia? 60%. So that's why we have, you know, our brothers here from China, okay, Jamie and his wife. They are responsible for 1.4 billion people. That's why they are here. And then our brother Dinesh and Caroline from India, they're responsible for another 1.5 billion. Of course, our brother Coco, not 1%, but he represents whole Asia as well, all right? He'll be leading us in prayer. So I'd like to welcome everyone again. If I mention your country, you stand up and be fired up, even though there's only 10 of you, all right? So I would like to welcome Malaysia, India, Pakistan, Zambia, Kenya, Sweden, Brazil, United Kingdoms, Kuwait, Angola, Nepal, Mozambique, Vietnam, South Africa, United Arab Emirates, Philippines, Australia, South Korea, Taiwan, United States, Thailand, Cambodia, Japan, China, Hong Kong, Singapore, and Indonesia. You know, the reason we chose Come Follow Me, because all of us here remember the time when we made that decision to follow Jesus. Many of us are still in campus, but we left everything. Get excited about Jesus with the fellowship and really believe that we can really go make disciples around the world. Now, today, we have responsibility to go and preach the gospel to 4.5 billion people. And that's the reason why we are here today. The fellowship is great. God has been with us. You know, the weather forecast mentioned that there will be storm these 4 days. But God has been good. God give us good sun. And it's awesome. And even last night when we had a dinner together, the rains is a blessing from God. It's like a dessert from God. And one of the things that we are so excited about when we see the disciples, even though you got rains, you still stay in the fellowship. If this is in the world, will be very scary. You know, people will come to us, you know, but disciples, everyone is so happy. First world, you guys bring your own umbrella. Third world, they're so creative. They go hide under the tables. But we are disciples.
Also, I think all the disciples from all over Nusantara, you have saved a long year to come to this conference. To all the brothers and sisters who travel from different countries, thank you for coming. And for China, 欢迎光临. I know we are so grateful for all your support. We are, you know, we're trying our best to serve you. And we hope that if there is anything that you need, let us know. And if there is anything that we miss, forgive us. I do hope that you enjoy the next few days. We love you.
Welcome everybody, Asian brother and sister. I think this is the closest thing you can get besides heaven. Yesterday when I arrived, when I saw the baptisms, the open area banquet, I want to start to worship the sea region. But I know it's not right. Because in the Bible, in Psalm 86, all the nations you have made will come and worship before you, Lord. They will bring glory to your name, for you are great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God. I think coming here, I'm so inspired and I see the glory of God. Amen.
Namaste. Namaste and Wanakam. That is greetings in Hindi and Tamil. We're excited that we are part of this amazing Asian Discipleship Summit, and we have representing 1.5 billion people, some disciples that came from India, Pakistan, Nepal, and we wish people from Bangladesh and Sri Lanka could come too. So we're excited to be part of this amazing conference. We're excited to be reminded of why we are all here. We all are brown sisters in Christ because of the blood of Jesus makes us as a family. And in the family, everybody's important, the youngest to the oldest. From India, for the first time, they left the country and their dream was to come to a conference like this. So they got their passport. When they found out there's an Asian Discipleship Summit, we have a couple who is 82 years old, Varghese uncle and auntie, can you please stand up? They come for the first time outside India to come to the conference. Saved up money to be part of this. So we are proud to have them. So that represents our entire region. So thank you, Indonesia, for hosting this conference. Let's all have a great time, brown sisters.
Now, today, besides all the singing, we all worship God. The focus today is for us to get our heart right. We know that the reason why it's all possible because of God. And we're going to have our brother, Sean Wooten, will be preaching and be used by God powerfully today. And the reason why we have Sean Wooten, because, I mean, we have been friends with Sean Wooten. We always, when we see each other, we call each other friend, because he is such a great friend. Not just a time when we just have a lot of laugh when life is easy, but even at a time when life is not easy, you're a true friend, Sean. And Sean was baptized in 1991 in Kansas, and God has used our brother Mark Templer to study the Bible with Sean. It's an amazing story. But I see in such a young age as a disciple, Sean was willing, when he heard there was a mission to go to Russia, he was willing to go there, to be part of the mission team in Kiev. He stayed over there, and that's also the time when he met a beautiful wife, Lena, and God has been using both of them powerfully to really spread the word in Russia. And many, many evangelists, leaders, disciples, because of the impact of how God used both of them. And Sean Wooten also has been used by God to help out with Hope Works in Russia. And recently, last few years, God has been calling them to go to Ukraine to lead all the churches in Eastern Europe. It is not about what he has accomplished and has done. I want every one of us here today to really understand what is God doing in his life and what is it that really pleased God. And I believe that today, as Sean preached, I pray that all of us here can get our heart, open up our heart and mind, and let the word of God to speak to each and every one of us here. So we're going to have our brother Coco to lead us on in prayer, and we're going to be singing two more songs, and our brother Sean Wooten will come forward and preach the word of God to us. Thank you.
Okay, so why don't we go ahead and hold hands with each other, and it's just right for us to bow before the Lord in prayer. Father, we are so amazed with what you have done here. Just to see so many people from different nations coming together to worship you. Father, I pray that we will all be reminded that this is not about us. It really is about you. And I pray that our hearts will be one with you, that our spirit will connect with you, O God. And may you bless the entire conference, that all of us would have the heart of Christ, Father. God, thank you once again for bringing everybody here today. and the next few days that we will experience heaven here on earth. May you be glorified, O Lord. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Are you fired up, church? Can you feel that Jesus is with us right now? Do you feel that God is with us right now? Amen. So are you ready to sing for Jesus? Are you ready to dance for Jesus? Let's stand up, church, because we're gonna sing and dance together. Amen. Come on, brothers, sisters, we dance together. Dance with us.
Sometimes I can feel a little shy. It's that I need to know that you are here. That's why I'm singing. Be with you, Lord.
When I'm down.
Be with you, Lord.
When I'm lonely.
Be with you, Lord.
When I'm tired.
Be with
you,
Lord.
I need you only.
Be with you, Lord.
When I'm down.
Be with you, Lord.
When I'm lonely.
Be with you, Lord.
When I need you, Lord. Everyone, dance with us. Sisters, you know, we come from the different nations, right? And we even have different languages.
Amen.
But you know, one thing for sure, we have the same God.
Amen.
So we're gonna sing hallelujah with one voice. Come on. Come on, dance with us. Thank you. Amen.
Amen. To be at the ADS. Amen, church. While they're getting us set up, why don't you stand up and hug a brother or sister? Amen. Come on, a quick little hug break. Okay, excellent. Let's be seated. Amen. Good morning, everybody. My name is Sean Wooten. It is such a blessing to be with you today. God has clearly blessed the Sea region, and a special thank you to the Bali Church and all the Indonesian churches for hosting this conference. Amen. I have several things here going on. I'm actually going to remove this one. 1 second. Excellent. A couple slides from my home. I want to thank each and every one of you. I know many of you had been praying when Kiev and the Ukraine had its different challenges with war and civil war. This is actually the hall that our church meets in. Are you seeing the slides? No slides? No slides? Slides? Ah, this is the hall when we were having our revolution, and we had been praying, and I know many Christians around the world were praying that God would please bring peace. This is the actual inside of the hall where our church would meet. But God is always good, and even when there's challenges in our country, God still brings people to Him. This is the Kiev Church of Christ. They say hello. This is our campus ministry, 171 brothers and sisters in our campus ministry in the Ukraine. They're very excited and fired up. These are 28 young brothers and sisters who are training to go into the full-time ministry to plant churches in the Ukraine and Eastern Europe. And of course, we're investing in the next generation, but we also take care of the older generation. We're excited that in the next couple months, we're going to be appointing 4 elders and their wives in the Ukrainian churches as well in Kiev. You know, it's awesome to be a Christian, but I feel like the biggest blessing I have in my life is my family. And I love my wife so much. She's from Moscow, and we have 2 awesome kids, Andrew and Diana. They're here at the conference as well, and we're so thankful to be here. Amen. One other picture from the Ukraine, and then we'll go into the lesson. There are many geese in the Ukraine. Now, geese, they love to go to church in the Ukraine. But you know, they don't fly to church, they walk to church. They waddle to church, but they're very devoted. They waddle a long ways to get to church. And then when they get into the church building, it's filled with geese. And all the geese are so fired up to be at church. And then one of the geese gets on stage and starts to preach. And the other geese are so excited. And the geese preacher says, "You can do great things for God. You can fly. You can see amazing things. God is so big." And all the geese are honk, honk, honk. They're very fired up. And then after the sermon, all the geese walk out of the building and they waddle home. You know, we don't want to be like those Ukrainian geese, because we didn't come into this building tonight just to hear something amazing and then walk home the same. We came here to change our picture of God. We came here to grow in our faith of what God can use us to do, because the 4 billion people living in Asia are counting on us to change our picture of God. Amen, church. We are going to fly home. We are not going to waddle home, because God is going to change our lives. Welcome, amen, church. You know, the name of the conference, Come Follow Me. Come. It's an invitation. It shows hospitality. It shows inclusion. We're going to do this together. Come. It shows a great desire. Follow. He knows where he's going. Follow means together. Follow means you don't have to know it all. Follow means we're going somewhere. Me, Jesus, follow me, the Son of God, your best friend, me, the Christ, me, the Savior, the Alpha, the Omega, the first and the last. Come, follow me. Amen, church. This is going to be a simple lesson today. The first point is come. Now, you guys have your Bibles, right? You have them turned on, right? Amen. Oh, and some people have a real Bible. It's a little dark in here to see the real Bible, but those who have a real Bible probably have it memorized. Come. Jesus does not want to just give you something. Jesus does not want to just teach you something. Jesus wants to be with you. Jesus wants to be with you. The most shocking thing about God to me is not that he created the universe. It's not that he created beautiful Bali. It's not that he parted the Red Sea or closed the mouths of lions. The most shocking thing about God to me is that he wants to talk to you. He wants to have a relationship with us. We get to talk to God. Amen, church. Blessed, Matthew chapter 5, verse 5. Blessed are the poor in spirit. You know, that doesn't make a lot of sense when you read it the first time. Poor in spirit. I thought we were supposed to be rich in spirit. I thought we're supposed to be filled with the Spirit. Why does Jesus say we're blessed if we're poor in spirit? You know, I thought about that. If this morning you missed breakfast, then right now you're poor in food. And right now you're thinking, I want to eat. And you're looking at me and you think, he looks a lot like a banana. Because when you're hungry, everything looks like food. When you're poor in something, you want more of it. If you woke up this morning and you think you're rich in spirit, then you don't need more spirit. But if you woke up this morning and you felt poor in spirit, then what do you want more than anything? You want God. If you're swimming under the water and you've been there for a few minutes, what are you poor in? Air. What do you want at that moment? Air. Whatever we're poor in, we want more and more. We have to see God and be poor in spirit. If you had a fish at home, you would not think you understood the entire ocean. When we look at the beautiful Bali sky and we see the stars, we don't think we've explored the entire universe. Even after 25 years of reading the Bible, do I really believe I understand everything about an infinite God? It would take 1,000 lifetimes to even scratch the surface of understanding who God is. It amazes me sometimes I can be bored in my relationship with God. How is it possible to be bored in a relationship that has infinite? I just have to change my mind. I'm not rich. I don't know it all. I've been a Christian for 25 years. I've read that verse before. Church, we need to be poor in spirit. We need to be hungry for God. Amen? There's an amazing verse. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. This is my favorite verse that I've read this year. Did you find it? So you can read it in your language. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. For who among men knows the thoughts of a man except the man's spirit within him? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. We have not received the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we may understand what God has freely given us. See, I know what I think. I know me. I know lots of things. I know everything about me. I even know things about me that nobody else knows. Why? Because I know my mind. Now, I don't know everything about you. I don't know everything about anybody because I don't have access to their mind. If I could be inside of Harlem's mind for 10 minutes, then I could see every thought and every memory. I would have access to all of Harlem's thoughts. His wife started to laugh. I think he's getting nervous. The Spirit searches the deepest things of God. I have access to the Spirit of God. When I pray and study the Bible, I can know the deepest things of God because the Spirit has searched all things of God, and I have the Spirit in me. And the Bible says we have the mind of Christ. There is no limit to a relationship with God. You can know things about God nobody's ever known. We can learn and study about God forever and ever. And never be tired. It's amazing. We have access to God's Spirit. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7, it says, the end of all things is near. Okay, that's not too encouraging. If someone walks up to you and say, oh, by the way,
your end is near. You're like, oh, great, thanks, appreciate that. You know, that's not super encouragement, but it's very important to understand. If the end is near, then we need to be close to God. And it says here, two things that help our prayers. It says, be clear-minded and self-controlled so that you can pray. You know, clear-minded, it means to have a good mind. Start your day with a clear mind. God loves you. God gave up his life for you. God wants to be with you for eternity. God chose you. God sacrificed his son for you. Then self-controlled. You know, I don't know about you, but often I can have plans and intentions, but then I don't follow through. Hey, bro, let's spend time tomorrow. Okay, great. And then I don't spend time with the bro tomorrow. If I don't write it down and I don't make a time, often it doesn't happen. I don't know about you, but sometimes I go to bed at night and I think, tomorrow I'm going to have an amazing time with God. It's going to be awesome. And then I wake up a little late or something happens and it's not as awesome. And then I think, okay, but after lunch, I'll have more time with God. Okay, it didn't work out at lunch. Okay, tonight, definitely tonight. I'll definitely do it tonight. Oh, okay, not today, but tomorrow, definitely. And I have these intentions, but I don't follow through. Self-control is so important to build a relationship with God. You will have many great appointments this week. Your most important appointment will be with God. Your most important conversation will not be at a table in a cafe. It will be when you close the door and you get on your knees and you talk to God. This conference will change your life. We will be very inspired by the fellowship, I know. But your time with God the next 3 days is the greatest moment of this conference for you. Amen, church. We all remember our special prayers. I believe at this conference you will have some special prayers. I remember that special prayer before I was a Christian when I got on my knees and I said, God, if you're out there, help me find you. 2 days later, I was invited to church. 2 weeks later, I was in Mark Templer's home, and he was helping an atheist repent. I remember my special prayer that my younger brother would become a Christian. 2 weeks later, he was baptized. I remember my special prayer for my older brother to be a Christian. I'm still praying that prayer. But he's coming to the World Discipleship Summit in St. Louis. He agreed to come. I remember that special prayer that God would send me on a mission team. And now I live in the Ukraine. I remember that special prayer that God would help me to repent, because when I went on the mission team, I was so prideful and I thought I was so cool and I was so arrogant. And all I cared about was myself. And I remember getting on my knees and saying, God, please forgive me. Please give me a second chance. Please use me. I remember the prayer I prayed when I thought someone was going to kill me with a broken bottle in St. Petersburg. Luckily, I got away. I remember the prayer a few months later when I got a phone call on Christmas Eve that my mom was dying. I got on my knees and I prayed, God, please save her life. And she died on New Year's. I remember the prayer I prayed when I started to work for Hope that Michael Jackson would come to our Hope event in Moscow. And he came. And then I taught him how to dance. He's a pretty good dancer, right? Okay, no, that's not true. I have to be truthful. I remember the prayer the day my son was born, the day my daughter was born, those special prayers. Remember the prayer the day my son and my daughter were baptized, very special prayers. I remember the prayer when I got on my knees and asked God to stop the fighting in the Ukraine. I'm still praying that prayer. I remember getting on my knees praying for this sermon. I hope it gets answered in a good way, amen? Do you have your history of prayer? Do you have your journal? Do you have your psalms, your answered prayers? And many of our prayers aren't answered yet. Some of them weren't answered at all, but we keep praying even 25 years later, and we never give up. Amen, church? There's nothing better than to come and be with Christ. One prayer I'm still thankful for today is that God blessed me with an amazing wife. We've been married 22 years. My greatest illustration of love is someone who's willing to live with me for 22 years. That takes a lot of forgiveness and patience. I would like to ask her to come up here on stage. She wants to share something.
This is so wonderful to see you all. It's such a privilege to be here. And such amazing opening for the conference. We can speak English in so many different accents, and it's so cool. I'm so grateful to be answered prayers. And I'm not just talking about my husband, even though it's very special that somebody prayed for you. I became a Christian in the beginning of Moscow Church. It was only third month of Moscow Church planting, and I was 104 baptism already. The first year of Moscow Church, it was 850 people who became a Christian. And when we would go to different conferences, people would ask, what are you guys doing? How does it grow? And we had no idea. I didn't believe in Jesus 2 weeks before I became a Christian. I actually made decision to stop disbelieving. And later, we understand what actually was happening. I learned that before Moscow Church planting was sent, disciples in United States and many other countries, they prayed, they fasted, they collect contributions. It was such a all-world church planting. And then we went from city to city, and people would say, whoa, we prayed for Moscow Church. We prayed for you people getting baptized. And we understood this is what was happening. God answered prayers of so many people. And then even now we meet people who've been given contribution for our churches for last 25 years, and they never saw any Russian soul. And when they see us, they cry because they feel it's a privilege. I'm just so grateful for the heart of the Christians who actually just invest in those who they will never see. And I know that many of us are these people, that so many disciples prayed and fasted and still doing this all around the world. I'm very grateful for all of your prayers, and I hope that it will be more prayers for each other after this conference. So that's all I want to say. Thank you.
At the end of this lesson, we will pray together and ask God to do miracles. Amen, church? Let's go to point number two. Hold. John 8. It's the theme scripture for this lesson, John 8, 31. Let's read this together. To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, if you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Amen, church? Now, this is a group of people that believed in Jesus. And he says, if you hold, that means we have a choice. We can hold or not hold. Then it says, if you hold, you're really my disciples. When he says, you're really my disciples, that means you could probably be a disciple or you could really be his disciple. It seems like there's two options here. We obviously want to be people that hold to the truth. I believe Jesus is saying, brothers and sisters in this hall, hold to my teachings. Hold. Hold on. Don't give up obeying Jesus' teachings. You know, I read the most amazing book on prayer I've ever read in my life. I want to recommend you to read this book. It's incredible about relationship with God. It's called The Bible. And then I read the most incredible book on leadership and character and self-control. It just totally blew my mind. It's called The Bible. And then I read the most incredible book about how to build relationships. how to build friendships and marriage and how to raise kids. It's the most amazing book I've ever read. You've got to read this one. It's called The Bible. Amen, church. We are a Bible church. We hold to the teachings of Jesus. You know, it's amazing how powerful God's word is. I was an atheist. 2 months later, I was praying to go on a mission team. How does that happen? How does that happen? You know, an amazing story. This woman in the picture in the middle, her name's Maria. And for the brother who's on the left of her in the blue shirt, his name's Andre. Andre's been a Christian for 18 years. And his mother, Maria, had never come to church ever. And she never wanted to. She hated the idea of coming to our church. She's very orthodox. One of the sisters in our church, her name's Lena, talked to Andre and said, Andre, I would like to just come to your mother and read the Bible. And she said, well, I'll ask her, but I'm not sure she's going to want to. So he asked her, Mom, is it okay if someone from our church just comes and reads the Bible with you? And she said, okay, fine, but I'm never coming to church. So our sister comes over and reads the Bible to her. And she reads all the verses in the New Testament about repentance and baptism and being saved. And after about an hour and a half of just reading lots of scriptures, she said, stop. And our sister said, what's wrong? She said, are you saying I need to be baptized? And she said, I didn't say anything today. I just read the Bible. Call my son. Oh, okay. Tell him I need to get baptized today. And our sister was like, well, we can read some more scriptures too. Let's read some more Bible. 2 weeks later, Maria became our sister. Amen, church. 18 years. The Bible changed her life. Now, a couple weeks, 2 or 3 weeks after that, unfortunately, Maria had a stroke. And she went into the hospital. And she was in a coma. And for a day and a half, she did not wake up. Then finally, she woke up from her coma, but the relatives were not in the room. There was only a lady laying next to her. So Maria wakes up from her coma, looks around, doesn't see any doctors or relatives, and she looks over and sees the woman laying next to her. And the woman laying next to her is looking at her. And Maria says to her, and I kid you not, she says, you need to get your life right with God. You need to study the Bible. And they started to talk. About an hour or so later, Maria fell back into a coma. Then the relative showed up, Andre, her son. And the woman laying next to her said, your mother woke up from the coma. And I said, she did? What did she say? Well, she told me I need to get my life right with God, that I should study the Bible. 6 or 7 hours later, that same day, Maria passed away and went on to be with God. Galina, the woman laying next to her, got out of the hospital and realized that she needed to study the Bible and get her life right with God. Galina studied the Bible, and she's now our sister in Christ. It is amazing. Maria, after 18 years, literally 3 weeks before she's going to die, a sister comes and reads the Bible to her. She wakes up from the coma for 2 hours, just long enough to share her faith with a woman laying next to her. And now she's our sister. God is so amazing. Amen, church. The word of God has so much power. Never doubt the word of God. If you're having a hard time, read the Bible. If you're having a great time, read the Bible. If you have any time, read the Bible. If you have a friend who you want to have faith in God, he just needs to read the Bible. We need to open the Bible. Amen, church. Luke chapter 5. This is a moment actually when Jesus was calling them to come follow me. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down the nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. Amen, church? Jesus has an idea. Let's fish with nets in the middle of the day. Now, if you ask a fisherman, that's a terrible idea. If you ask Peter, who has so much experience, that's a terrible idea. And they're tired. But because Jesus said so, he did it. And he saw an amazing miracle. I have a wish for everyone sitting in this hall today. It is great that we have matured and that our churches are getting older and we have mature Christians. That's a good thing. But sometimes our maturity can make us think we don't just need to obey. We're still children of God. We still just obey. Jesus is Lord. And we need to obey the scriptures. Yeah, but bro, I tried that, you know. Bro, how do you feel about that? No, I don't. I did that in the past. That didn't work out so well. I'm not going to do that anymore. How about serving here? No, that's not really my gift set. Hey, let's go out there and just share our faith. No, I tried that. That doesn't work. This is the only thing that works. No, deep water doesn't work, Jesus. Only the shallow water. No, not the left side of the boat, Jesus. Only the right side of the boat. Sometimes we think we figured it out. And we only do what we want to do when we feel like it. Jesus says, obey. Obey my teachings. Amen, church. You know, I dreamed to be a doctor. I always wanted to be a doctor when I was growing up. Then I got to college. When I got to college, to become a doctor, you have to learn a foreign language, and you have to take a public speaking class. When I found out I have to learn a foreign language and I have to take a public speaking class, I dropped out of pre-med and decided to become an engineer. Because if I'm an engineer, I don't have to talk to anybody, and I don't have to learn a foreign language. That didn't really work out so well for me. When we become Christians, anything is possible. God can do things with us we never dreamed were possible. We can never give up doing the right things. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Do our best to hold to the teachings, but then there's grace when we fail. I'm so happy this verse does not say, blessed are those who hunger and thirst are, no. I'm very happy it doesn't say, blessed are those who are righteous. I'm very thankful that verse does not say, blessed are those who are righteous. Because if that was the case, I would not be very blessed. Because I'm not very righteous. I'm thankful this verse says, blessed are those who are hunger and thirst for righteousness. Those who keep giving their hearts even when it doesn't work out. They stay hungry and they stay thirsty. I love music. What an incredible opening, amen? Incredible singing, incredible performance. I was hoping it wouldn't end. I was willing to skip my sermon for more singing. I love music. My passion for music is here. I sing songs. And so then when I sing songs, of course, the dogs are like, arr! It never sounds good. I have no talent with music, but I have a lot of passion. So my passion for music is here. My ability is down here. Our passion to be like Jesus is up here. We're filled with passion. We just want to be like Jesus. Now, my ability to be like Jesus, well, but then Satan attacks us and says, Sean, why are you so zealous if actually you're this type of Christian? You're a hypocrite. You should be more sad. You should be more somber because you're actually not doing so well. You should be a little bit depressed. Don't be too joyful because you're not really that great. No! Blessed is this group of people because we can be filled with passion for Jesus and then the grace makes up the difference. Don't let anyone steal your joy. Amen, church. Don't let anyone tell you that you can't be passionate. None of us are perfect. Blessed are those of us who stay hungry and thirsty even after 20 years. Amen, church. I remember when we planted the church in Kiev. 500 people were at the first church service. 28 people were baptized the first week. 77 the first 3 weeks. And do you know what? From the mission team that went to plant the church in Kiev, there was only one person on the team who didn't help anyone to become a Christian. There was only one person on the team who didn't have any visitors on Sunday. 500 visitors. And I was the only one who didn't help anyone to become a Christian. I was so prideful and so arrogant, God just didn't bless me. And I remember Sunday service, I didn't have anyone to study the Bible with. I was sad, I was discouraged. I thought, okay, I'm not going to give up. Tomorrow I'm going to share my faith all day. And then tomorrow night is first principles. We're going to study the Bible with people. And God, please bring someone Monday night. So Monday morning I get up and I go out and I share my faith with 100 people. And then I come to church service Monday night and I come to the hall. Nobody showed up. After church, everyone's studying the Bible with someone except me. And I was discouraged. I remember walking out of the hall that night, sitting in the metro all by myself because everyone else was busy studying with people. I was all alone. Sat there discouraged. And I sat. After a couple minutes, I looked up and I see these four people standing by the door of the metro. And you know, sometimes the Spirit just tells you,
go.
Invite them. And I was like, what are you talking about? I've been inviting for 6 days. I'm done. I'm taking a break. And I sat there quietly. The doors opened. They didn't leave. The doors closed. And I look at them again. And the Spirit's like, you should go invite them. I'm like, what do you mean I should go invite them? No. It doesn't work for me. The doors opened, they didn't leave, it closed again. I thought, oh, I was actually hoping they'd leave, so I stopped thinking I should invite them. So I negotiated with God. I said, okay, God, if they don't get out after the next stop, I'll get up and invite them. The doors opened, and I almost prayed, God, get them out, leave, leave. Maybe I should push them out, I don't know. The doors closed, I thought, okay, I'll go invite them. I stand up, walk over, and I say, would you like to come to the Church of Christ tomorrow night? They're like, sure. And I was like, yeah, right. You know, I was like, yeah, whatever. I gave him the invitations, and I go back and I sit down discouraged. Have you ever had a day like that? The next night, he shows up. He wants to study the Bible. We start meeting every morning to study the Bible. Then it was my turn to go. We had to leave Kiev and go to St. Petersburg. He actually got baptized after I left. But a month ago, I decided to figure out, you know, when I invited him, and there was a girl who also came and got baptized, when I invited him and her that night, who then did they invite, and who did they invite, and who did they invite? I was just curious what God did with one of the worst nights of my Christian life. Watch this video. We're going to need the sound here. Is it playing? Can we have the sound? God is amazing. In those pictures, there's 8 different church leaders and evangelists, and there's 4 kids in the School of Missions right now, and Kingdom Kids. I had no motivation. I had no faith. I just obeyed. I just got up, walked over, opened my mouth, and obeyed. And God did a miracle. And all the other days when I was praying and fasting, and at my peak, nothing happened. I'm not suggesting that we should have lots of bad days. I'm just suggesting, just obey the scriptures. Don't make it about your feelings. Don't make it about your attitude. Don't make it about you. Just obey the scriptures. Amen, church? Last point, number 3, free. John 8:32. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. We like the word free, amen? The free you. I want us to look at this. I think you're going to be amazed by what God has already done in your life. One second, let me get it up here. The Bible says, you may not be able to see these because it'll be in small, but I just want to run through them for you. When you were baptized, something happened to you that is unbelievable. Now, you will be challenged during the conference to grow in certain areas, but even the things you will grow in don't even come close to what God's already done in you. This is very important to understand. You are a new creation. The old is gone. It's gone. It doesn't exist. You're absolutely new. You are the temple of God. People would travel thousands of miles to look at the temple. Now all they have to do is cross the street and walk in your apartment, and they will see the temple of God. You carry the Holy Spirit. You are carrying God. If you told someone 2,000 years ago that you were carrying God, you would be stoned. It's unfathomable that you would carry God, and we'll talk about that in a moment. You were poor, now you're rich. This is the richest people in Asia sitting in this room right now. There's nobody as rich as you. I know you're opening your wallet. He said, what's he talking about? I'm as poor. Your soul is worth more than the entire world. There's never one been as rich as you. You were dead, now alive. You were absolutely dead. There was no pulse. There was nothing. And you came alive. You were in darkness. Darkness, scary darkness. Can't see anything. You don't know what's going to happen to you. Complete darkness. Now you're in the light. You had no mercy. Now you have mercy. All it would take is one sin to separate you from God for eternity. One sin, that's all it takes. We have incredible mercy, church. You were lost. Could you imagine going to sleep on a raft on the beach in Bali and then waking up and all you see is sea around you? And there's no life, no shore, nothing? How would you feel? And then who shows up is not a person, it's a fin circling around you? How would you feel if you were totally lost? Jesus came and found you. You've been found. You were an object of wrath. I don't know what an object of wrath for you is, but for me, it's like a cockroach or a mosquito. You don't want to keep them in your house. You don't give them a cage. We were objects of wrath before God. Now we're his beloved children. You were condemned. Now you're saved. Amen, church. The most amazing one is this one. 1 John 3. This is utterly astounding. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. This is the most shocking idea ever. You are a child of God. How is that even possible? How is that even possible? Now, we're in Bali, right? And there's beautiful beaches, and you can go underwater and see the fish. And if you have one of those little sticks that goes in your mouth, you can stay under a long time. And if you have those big tanks on your back, you can go under even deeper for a long time. But eventually, you have to come up. Because you cannot live in the water. You cannot live in the sea. You're not capable of existing underwater. For you to live underwater, you would have to grow gills and have fins and become a fish. Otherwise, you will die in that situation. You cannot exist in that situation. We as people cannot coexist with God. It is impossible. God cannot be around sin. God cannot be in the presence of sin. You would have to be completely pure. You would have to be completely perfected to be in God's family. You could coexist with God like a snorkel or with tanks. You could be around him like in the Old Testament. They were around the temple. They would kill animals and put on robes so that they could come close, so they could kind of be around God. But they could not coexist with God because they're human. You would have to be totally transfigured to coexist with God. Otherwise, you would be destroyed immediately. We don't just coexist around God. God lives in you. You carry the Holy Spirit of God in you. You don't have to pray for that. You don't have to repent for that. It's already there. All these things I talked about today, you don't have to strive for these things. It's already there. But we have to believe it. We have to see it. And if we see ourselves for the way God really created us, nothing's impossible. But if we see ourselves as the old us, the poor me, the object of wrath me, the weak me, if we see ourselves like we see ourselves, we won't accomplish what God wants us to do. We have to believe the scriptures. Amen, church. We cannot give up. I'm very proud of my wife. She's never given up on trying to convert her family. So proud of her. Mother was so against her baptism, she even threatened to hurt herself if Lena would get baptized. Lena got baptized, and a few years later, Lena's grandmother, who was like 80 years old, got baptized. Then Lena's mother became a Christian. Then Lena's sister became a Christian. Then Lena's sister's husband became a Christian. And right now, her father is studying the Bible. Please pray for her father to become a Christian. But I wanted to share with you, I flew once to Moscow to study the Bible with her father. It's a one-hour flight from Kiev to Moscow. And when we were flying to Moscow, there was some rain and stuff, so we were circling a little bit. It was about an hour and a half had passed, and then finally the pilot said, we're coming in for a landing. And we come in for a landing, and as we're getting close, should I stay here in the light? Darkness is bad. Light is good. Darkness bad. And as we were coming in for a landing, it got really dark. Clouds got really dark, and it got a little bumpy. You know how that happens. It gets a little bumpy. And then as we're coming in, we get about 100 meters from the ground. And I already see the ground, and I'm getting, okay, good, we're about to land. And then the pilot hits the gas, pulls up, and the plane starts to go up. And it's bouncing, 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 bouncing. And then we break through the clouds. I was hoping we were going to land. We didn't land. We start to circle for about another hour. We're in the air for like 2.5 hours. And then the pilot says, we're going to try to land again. So we start coming in for landing. It goes completely dark again, clouds, and it's bumpy, bumpy, bumpy. And then we're about 200 meters from the floor again, and he hits the gas, pulls up, and we go up again. And like hail, these pellets are hitting the plane. And we go bumpy, bumpy, bumpy. We go through the clouds like, oh. And I thought, I'm never getting off this plane. This is it. Aeroflot. Forever. 4 hours now, we're circling. The pilot comes on and says, now we're going to land at a different airport. We're going to go off to the different airport and land. And we're like, oh, okay. So we fly. It's about 30 minutes, about 20 minutes we fly, and we finally land. And you know, sometimes when a plane lands, some people stand up right away, some people stay seated. This time, everybody stood up. Everyone applauds like we just won the World Cup. And we're ready to get off the plane. We're all excited. I kid you not, 10 minutes pass, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, the door does not open. After a half hour, the pilot comes on and says, "We're just refueling. We're not getting off. We're flying back to the other airport." I look at the emergency door. I'm thinking, I'm going to try and open the emergency door. Let me out of here. You should have seen everyone's face. It was like. So then the stewardess start to pass out free vodka. You must have joy in the airplane. I kid you not, they were passing out vodka for free. I didn't drink any. I'm okay. I'm Christian. So then we take off. Steward, the captain says, 20-minute flight, we'll be landed. 20 minutes pass, 30, 40, an hour. I kid you not, hour and a half. Lightning out of the left window, lightning out of the right window. They can't land the plane. Finally, I left at 5. It was 12:30 night. 7.5 hours later, we land in Moscow. Now, the reason I'm telling you this story is not to inspire you about Aeroflot. What if the pilot, after 2 hours, came on the intercom and said, "Ladies and gentlemen, I'm done. This was supposed to be an hour flight. I hung in there an extra hour. I'm done. Good luck getting home on your own." And then he turns on some music. What would you do? I'd start, "Hey, pilot, sit back down. Land the plane." Then the pilot would come on and say, no, I'm not going to land the plane. I didn't sign up for this lightning. I didn't sign up for this second landing. I didn't sign up for all this. I don't want all that. I just was going to fly it and that's it. "Pilot, sit back down. You have to land the plane. My life depends on it." Church, you will have challenges in your Christian life. You'll have bumpy. You'll have storms. You'll have lightning. You'll think it would take 1 hour to land it. It'll take you 7 hours. But you can't give up. We cannot quit. "But God, I didn't sign up for Chernobyl. I didn't sign up for 2 wars, Civil War, Revolutionary. I didn't sign up for all this." Sean, sit back down. Land the plane. Your family's in the plane. Your neighbors are in the plane. Your colleagues are in the plane. Church, I know Christian life is hard. I know we have trials, but you have to finish what you started. This world needs you to finish what you started. Sit back down. Too much is at stake. The world needs to hear the message. Amen, church. Come follow me. If you follow someone, you end up where they are. If we follow Jesus, we're going to end up where he is. The day is coming when you're going to walk down the streets in Singapore, Tokyo, Hong Kong, Shanghai, Bali. And as you're walking down the street, all of a sudden you're going to hear this noise, like this trumpet or this choir of trumpets, and it's getting louder and louder. You're thinking, where is this noise coming from? And you're looking around and you realize everyone's stopped and everyone's looking around. Where is this noise coming from? Then it gets louder and louder. Then all of a sudden the sky's going to rip open like curtains. And this incredible light's going to pour through the opening. And millions of colors will flood out, colors you've never even seen before. And at this moment, a swarm of angels is going to come through, thousands upon thousands and millions and millions. And all their wings are moving in unison. And they're chanting, "Holy, holy, holy." And when you see all this, you're thinking, "Oh my gosh, it doesn't matter that I don't have any money. It doesn't matter, I forgot to buy the milk. It doesn't matter, nothing's gonna matter at that moment. And as it fills up with angel after angel after angel, then all of a sudden the wings stop and the chanting stops and you could hear a pin drop. And at that moment, all the angels turn towards the opening. And at that moment, a man with the silhouette of a king riding on a horse comes through the opening. And he announces, I'm the Alpha, the Omega, the first and the last. And when he says this, all the angels fall on their knees. You fall on your knees. All the atheists, all the Buddhists, all the entire world falls on its knees. And you're crouched down on the ground thinking, okay, what's next in Revelation? Okay, what happens next? Okay, praise God, I'm a Christian. Amen. And at that moment, you start to come up. You start to float up. And you get a couple meters off the floor thinking, oh my gosh, I'm flying. This is so awesome. I've always wanted to fly. And you get above the trees and the palm trees and you see the brothers. Bro, check me out. Sister, I guess we won't have a date tonight, but no big deal, amen. And you start to float up. And the fellowship starts and all the Christians in Bali are high-fiving. And then they see the Christians from Singapore and from Thailand and from Manila and from India and from China and the Ukraine, amen. Pray for the Ukraine, we need to be there too, amen. But the entire world goes up and then you're fired up in the fellowship and then all of a sudden you look up and you see him. You see Jesus. You've pictured him 1,000 times, but you never knew what he looked like. And you can't take your eyes off of him. All of a sudden, you don't even see the fellowship. You're just looking at Jesus. And you get closer and closer until he's directly with you. And you're standing in front of him, and he looks you in the eye, and he says, I'm so proud of you that you didn't give up. Welcome home. Church, that's why we're here. We live for that day when Jesus brings us home. Let's pray together as we finish this lesson. Come, follow me. Father, we are totally amazed at your plan for us. Father, it's hard for us to even understand what you've done to change us. Father, that we carry your Holy Spirit, that we are a part of your family, that we're your dearly loved children. God, we're so thankful that you've saved us from the darkness, that you rose us from death spiritually, and that we can live our lives with a mission of saving souls. God, help us to never give up. I know some of us came here struggling and even thinking of giving up. Help us to never give up and love you with all of our hearts. Help us to have our best prayer times we've ever had these next 4 days. Please work powerfully through your scriptures when brothers and sisters preach the word so that our lives will be changed forever. Thank you for the invitation to come. We're so thankful you just want to be with us. Thank you for the challenge to hold. Help us give our whole hearts to just being your children and obeying your word. And Father, thank you so much for setting us free. Thank you that we're a new creation and we can live our lives for you. Thank you for this conference. Please bless every heart and soul in this room and bless all the brothers and sisters who could not travel to be with us. Please help the Sea region and all the Asian churches to multiply into churches of thousands and even millions. God, we love you. Thank you for this time to worship you, to read your scriptures, and be inspired by your love for us. We pray for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Good afternoon, church.
Follow me.
raised. Amazing grace, pour me a crown away.
Indescribable joy.
Day when you wipe my tears away.
Measurable
peace. As you hold me when you welcome me home.
Sisters, let's stay hungry, let's stay thirsty for righteousness. Let's continue to have an obedient heart. Let's finish what we have started. Sean, thank you for challenging and inspiring all of us here. And church, let's not walk home, let's fly home. Let's thank Sean one more time. It's time for some announcement. First of all, for all the speakers, please come up to the stage to meet up with Harlem right after the class, right after this session. Secondly, it's for all the participants, please make sure that you have your badge with you all the time. You know, to enter the building, you need to have your badge. And please keep all your belongings all the time with you. Please keep all your belongings all the time with you. If you found any lost and found, please bring it to the information desk right at the south lobby on the left side there. You can do live streaming and download all the lessons at the comefollowme2016.com. So all the things that are happening right now is in the live streaming at comefollowme2016.com. Thank you to the IT team. For the breakout classes after this, all the women, please stay in this room. All the women, please stay in this room. And all the men, we look ahead to the Uluwatu rooms. All will be Uluwatu rooms will be in ground floor. And the Kintamani rooms, the K rooms, all will be in the mezzanine floor. So you need to take an escalator up. Today's lunch will be served in a buffet style. Please have your lunch wherever your classes will be finishing, and stay there for the lunch. The bus drop and pick up, please pay attention to this one. There's a flyer being given to you when you registered. And all the bus details were there. And for today, as you are leaving for your hotels, I just want to let you know all the exits. The south gate, which is straight in front of me, the south gate will offer the hotels in the area A. Area A and B in the south gate. This direction. And area C will be in east gate, which is that direction. Okay, east gate. It's very important. We have 5,000 over people. We need to manage this right. Otherwise, it will be very fun. The airport shuttle for the 20th of June. Airport shuttle of 20th of June, you need to fill up a special form. Please register at the information desk, registration desk, right at the south gate for your departure if you need one. The optional excursion, just a quick one. Tomorrow, for some of you that book your optional excursion, please exchange your e-ticket at the registration desk after this or at the lunchtime. The water rafting and the safari will be leaving this place at noon, at 12 p.m. Okay, so you're not going to have lunch here, but you're going to have a lunch box with you. So you'll be leaving at 12 noon tomorrow and Sunday. For the shopping and the Tanah Lot and Hope will be at 2 p.m. Last but not least, this is a very, very special CD prepared for you. There are three CDs in a bundle. Okay, the three sisters here, we just sang. They call themselves the Voice of Truth. Let's give a big hand of applause to them too. And also a CD prepared by the Song Ministry from the Jakarta Church will be sold out. We sold out there at the merchandise counter for 150,000 for the three CDs. Please grab the CDs. Now I want to invite Harlem for a very, very special announcement.
Well, Budi actually is supposed to be announcing this, but he asked me to come forward because this is about the news of the brother that is actually in charge of the video for the conference. His name is Sudung, and God just called him last week. And it was very sad for every one of us. He's a brother that working so hard, and in the morning, while he was having a quiet time, his wife Eva found him dead, basically imbued with the Lord. And it was very saddening to us. If you can show the picture there, Sudung, we love him. And but so many people have been really working hard, and I just want to appreciate everyone who's been working hard, and especially Budi Hartono is the one that is actually really making all these things happen. And also, I would like to mention a few names here, because for this conference, we want people to not just come a few days for the conference. We had great fellowship and all that. We know that. But most importantly is while we are back in our own city. Because of that, we prepared a quiet time series, and we asked four brothers to write the series from the whole four books of the gospel. And we would like to thank Brother Matthew Lim from Singapore, who wrote, you know, a quiet time for Book of Matthew, and then our brother Roland Monhey for Book of Mark, and then a brother Mark Templer, Book of Luke, and then our brother Malcolm Cox for the Book of John. So this has been really great. It's a great quiet time book, and it's great for us to even continue reading that during the conference and even after the conference. So again, thank you very much. This is the our schedule. We'll be having 11 classes, start at 11:30. Okay, so all the women are going to be here, but all the brothers will split up into 11 classes. Thank you very much.